Penguin Random House Audio presents The Adversary by Michael Crummey. Read for you by Mary Lewis.
For Mike Basha. Although a black hole does not emit light, matter falling toward it collects in a hot, glowing accretion disk that astronomers can detect. sbs.gsfc.nasa.gov. But they lie in wait for their own blood. They ambush their own lives. Proverbs. The Driven Snow, A Winter Wedding. There was a killing sickness on the shore that winter, and the only services at the church were funerals. The beadle stood at the bare wooden table that served as an altar in his shapeless cloak and black skullcap, offering a reading and a prayer over the departed. There was no sermon, and no hymns were sung. The few people well enough to mourn the dead carried them to their rest, rasping shallow graves in the frozen earth. The sanctuary was almost empty on the day of the wedding as well, and there was the same forsaken air about the occasion as the sparsely attended funerals. The bride was a girl of 14, her hands manacled in a fur muff on her lap. Everyone in the church but her father was a rank stranger, and even her father the youngster barely knew. He was a merchant from Jersey, 20 years in Newfoundland, but for spending every second winter with his wife and daughters in the old country. He'd arrived home in September as planned, but stayed just long enough to attend to immediate business before shipping out again. And against her mother's useless protests, he packed his oldest daughter along for the journey. She had never been to sea, and they sailed into storm as soon as they left the channel, the vessel shipping green water as each wave overwhelmed the bow. She didn't leave her cabin for sickness and for fear of being swept overboard the entire voyage. The groom was late for the ceremony, and Misters Matterface and Heater were dispatched to find him. The girl had laid eyes on her intended only once, when he came to her father's house with the beadle the day after her arrival. The three men fell into a protracted discussion while she sat in the parlor, rocking slightly in her chair as if she was still at sea. She spoke little English and gleaned almost nothing from the conversation, though there was a businesslike sullenness to the back and forth, as if the men were negotiating the cost of a schooner or a hogshead of curing salt. Before leaving, they stepped into the parlor, and her father introduced one of the men as her fiancé. The second he introduced as the beadle, who would sanctify their marriage directly. But she couldn't shift her eyes from the sight of the one she was spoken for. He was a fright for a child to look upon as a prospective husband, bacon-faced, with a small, full mouth that gave him the air of a greedy infant. He looked her up and down in her seat as if vetting a questionable purchase before turning to say something she didn't understand to her father. The beadle inclined slightly toward her, a bow of apology, it seemed, and he took the man's arm to lead him out. Almost 3 months she'd been kept to herself then, until the illness burnt itself to embers, and those who survived the scourge agreed the wedding could proceed. A fire rattled in the church stove, but the windows were rimed with frost, and the few wedding guests sat in a wooden silence. The girl stared at the expensive beaver muff as she waited, raising the fur to her face now and then to wipe at the clear line of snot on her upper lip. She could not feel her feet for the cold. The door to the church opened behind them, and everyone turned expectantly. The man who entered stopped to glance about the hall, surprised, no doubt, by the groom's absence. He removed his woolen hat, his dark hair clipped severely at the back and sides, and combed to one side. It took the bride a moment to realize a girl had come in behind him, a servant wearing a gray bonnet and a length of rough calico about her shoulders as a shawl. It was almost impossible to tell with servants, but she thought they might be near the same age, herself and this girl. The newcomers sat together at the back of the room, and the young man shrugged out of his overcoat, revealing a fashionable dragon green jacket over a striped waistcoat with two watch fobs. He nodded at a handful of those present and eventually caught the bride's eye and held it. She felt oddly naked in the light of that stranger's gaze. There was something comfortless but knowing in it. And before her father nudged her attention away, she surprised herself by wishing it was him she was about to marry. The groom arrived finally in the company of Matterface and Heater, not so much hung over as still in his altitudes. He walked between the two men like a prisoner being led to a cell under guard. He took his place at the wooden altar table, ferret-eyed and stinking, and his escorts stepped to one side as the father of the bride delivered the girl to stand next to him. He didn't look at her or his future father-in-law, nodding at the beadle to indicate he should get on with things.
"We are gathered here today," the beadle said, "to witness the joining together of this man, Abe Strapp, and this woman, Anna Morell, in the bonds of holy matrimony. Who gives this woman to be married?"
The Jerseyman nodded his head.
"I do," he said.
He remained at the bride's side, though his official duties were completed. He whispered a translation of the beadle's words to his daughter as the bare ceremony progressed, though the buzzing of panic in her ears made it difficult to follow. She fixed on the beadle as he spoke, on his lenten-jawed face, on his peculiarly equipped mouth, a full set of ivories on the left, the gums on the opposite side boasting not a single tooth. The division so even, it seemed impossible it could be accidental, and not part of some unfortunate design.
"If anyone present," the beadle said.
He paused there and sighed.
"Know of any reason why these two should not be joined in matrimony? Let them speak now or forever hold their peace."
The groom's eyes were closed and he seemed half asleep on his feet until he startled at the sound of a woman's voice behind them. The girl turned to follow his look to the back of the hall and was surprised herself to see the man in the green jacket and striped waistcoat on his feet.
"That bloody witch," Strapp said.
The beadle placed his hand on the groom's arm.
"You have an objection to this marriage, Widow Keynes?"
The girl stared at the figure of the man she'd wished to marry moments before, the narrow shoulders, the hips, the face that looked almost the face of an adolescent boy but for the eyes which were certain, unflinching, and the high, clear voice of a woman. "The banns of this union have not been published according to custom," the Widow Keynes said.
"And what do you care for Christly custom?" Strapp called back to her.
"Mr. Strapp," the beadle said.
The girl's father left her side and took a seat in the front pew. She didn't know if she was meant to follow him or not, and she stood where she was, watching the strange creature in green. The beadle said,
"The late affliction has disrupted much of our custom, Widow Keynes. We have not held regular service since the death of your husband."
"Of course," the woman said. "I would have raised my objection weeks ago otherwise." She turned to motion the servant girl to her feet.
"This is Imogen Purchase. She has been in my employ these last 2 seasons. "What has she to do with these proceedings?"
the beadle asked. "Miss Purchase is willing to swear that at the end of September last, Mr. Strapp encountered her while she was alone at Looking Glass Pond,"
and that Mr. Strap did, without her invitation or permission, force himself upon her. Strap pointed at the servant girl. I never laid eyes on this maid in all me born days.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.